Today, and I'm sure all of you have some R&D experience. You know, I don't have to tell you what is R&D, research and development. And the course is teaching engineering effectively. So I thought before I could go to our slides, maybe I'll debate a bit why R&D experience is useful to teach engineering courses effectively. Right. Now, engineering is the basis of technology. And as you know, technology is basically enabler. It enables you to develop products, solutions, services, create new things. But the basis is engineering, where you lay the basis through engineering education. But it is linked to technology, and technology, because of its sort of link to business, it changes very rapidly. So there are a lot of dynamics. So technology changes very rapidly. And if I give an example, it's probably it's an old example, but it tells the point I'm trying to make very clearly. Long back we had vacuum tubes, now we have transistors, now we have gone to VLSI. So technology has changed. So we don't teach vacuum tube anymore. Likewise, we had mechanical watch, it has gone to digital watch. There is very little market for mechanical watch. So mechanical watch knowledge has gone into somewhere else. It's no longer useful. These are called paradigm shift. Paradigm is a set or a cluster of rules and techniques that sort of determine the boundary within which you can solve problems, do new things, create products. Okay, so rules and governing techniques are there. Now, when the paradigm shifts from one state to another state, all the rules and techniques you have learned now has practically zero value. It's of no use. You have to learn new rules, new techniques to do the same thing in a better and more effective way. So as the paradigm shift occurrence becomes more frequent, it's our duty as a teacher to bring in and see this paradigm change and bring into the content of the course and teach it more effectively. So this paradigm change occurs through R&D work. R&D work, intense R&D work in large industries, intense R&D work in research intensive universities, and that brings in the paradigm change. So we got to know this. We may not be expert or we may not be doing research, but we should have some kind of awareness in this to make the course more relevant to the students. So that thought one reason why R&D experience is useful. And second is you might be feeling like I do, that a lot of our leaders and so-called heavyweights are talking about innovations. In India, I stands for innovations. And the overall picture is that we are trying to bring in innovations in everything we do. I think that's our attempt. And in engineering education is a place where innovation naturally fits in, because you innovate things and create products, create new services, and create solutions for the benefit of the society. So to bring in innovation into engineering curriculum, okay, now one can say, okay, now you teach a course, innovation, first course on innovation, second course on innovation. I personally think it's not a very effective way of doing it. We need to bring in innovation, maybe a bit of it, and integrate to the course we are teaching. We may be teaching a course on fluid mechanics, but bring in innovations there. Bring in innovation a bit in the components of learning in this thing. So to do that, it's good to have in parallel some R&D activities going. Okay, so I thought I should sort of put forward my view why R&D experience is useful in teaching engineering effectively. Okay, now before you go to the first slide, I'm going to continue on this. Before you go to the first slide, I'd like to sort of encourage you to interact, you know, during the session. You know, let's bring in cooperative learning and teaching, and you contribute from your experience to the learning of others. So I'd like to encourage that. So, you know, and as you say, you have to be in dialogue, not monologue. So we can do that, and please feel free, and as you bring in your as you ask a question or bring in your comments, suggestions or input, you can just say a sentence, telling your name and affiliation, so that I have a chance to come to know you. Okay, all right, continuing on that, why R&D? Of course, I have given a fancy title, R&D journey, but essentially you are going to talk about mundane things, how to write R&D proposals for research grants, for research contracts from industry and things like that. Continuing on this why R&D in an academic institutions, the first 2 points I have probably spoken in a different way. Okay, just a minute back, that you need to bring in innovation or creative learning into the classroom, and that needs kind of research experience. And then, of course, research always advances knowledge or applies knowledge, and all these you do for the benefits of the society, give back to the society. Okay, so that's the things, share things with the society. That also you can do in making a very sort of sustained R&D journey in an academic institutions. Well, that's fine, but then what are from the personal fronts? Personal fronts are important, because we are all human being. We are not all sadhus. We are all human being, and to be enthusiastically participating in things, we have to look at the personal fronts. If you see the last 3 bullets, kind of address that questions, like your visibility as a faculty member. I'm not talking about international visibility, but visibility as a faculty member in nation is related to your R&D output in general. Okay, and visibility, it's a difficult to define term, but visibility is almost like, just to put it in a very light manner, it's like stock price. You know, if your visibility is high, means your stock price is high, you are wanted, and people want to talk to you, interact with you, and things like that. And that is kind of related to your R&D output, or definitely related to how good you are a teacher, because your students are the they are going to build the network and make you visible also. So if they have liked your the electrifying effect you bring in your classroom teaching, in inspiring them, they would remember and they would do the thing. So teaching is probably number one, and then comes your R&D output, which is going to increase your visibility nationally. Then, if you have really done some very practical innovations in developing a product or generating a solution, then industry would be interested in it, because we are talking about technical things. Industry would be interested in it. And with the current economic prosperity and the industry is feeling very buoyant, you can build partnership with industry to generate wealth. Once you generate wealth, you are going to share the wealth you generate. So you become rich, put it simply. So there is a chance also becoming rich or share the generated wealth by doing good R&D, technical R&D. And finally, there are some missionary people, as a child you have observed something, you have observed a sick person having, let's say, cancer. It becomes your mission to cure that, develop a cure for it. So then you have a significant problem in your mind which has been registered just by observing. Okay? And you want to do that, and you can do that in an academic institution where you have a lot of freedom for doing R&D, as well as you have facilities and resources for doing good R&D. where I need not have said this, because I'm sure that most of you have some kind of feeling that R&D is important. But I thought, in the beginning, let me set a background that why you should take up this journey in an academic institution. This is again something it's very, very basic. You have fundamental or basic research and applied research. But if you talk about engineering, a very simple definition of engineering is application of science to meet the needs of the society. Let's say it's a very simple, crude definition. So it's application. Application comes first. So when you talk about R&D in engineering, so it has to be applied kind of research. And that is true. But even that, in applied research, you have a basic component. Basic component essentially means developing new tools, new techniques, new data, new information, new knowledge, so that you can do the same thing in a better way. Okay, so those are engineering science development. And so that is what I put. Basic would be advancing knowledge, creation of knowledge base. Those are the basic research. And from my personal experience and, looking at my other colleagues, my suggestion would be, particularly to my younger colleagues, that you begin with basic research. Focus more on basic research initially, the beginning of your R&D career. Because that way, you are enthusiastic, you'll equip yourself with more knowledge, more enabling tools and techniques, okay? And then if you go through that journey for, let's say, 10, 15 years, okay? Then you can embark on more on applied, that is whatever techniques and tools you have equipped yourself, you implement that in solving some significant problems. So it's not that you have to stop applied and do basic in the beginning, or stop basic and do applied. No, it is shifting the focus. Maybe you can start more focus, you put more focus on the basic, and while in parallel you do applied, and that you can do. That's just a, from my personal experience, it works that way. And of course, applied research is direct application. It may not be, but it's not trivial applications. You solve a lot of difficult issues as you implement. It's easy to say, easy to generate ideas, but implementing ideas is entirely a different thing. And in application, you basically implement. And your ideas remain empty if you don't implement and bring in tangible benefits out of your ideas. So implementation details are not trivial at all. They are as tough as many difficult research. So those who do applied research, don't feel yourself that, you are not doing basic research and you are doing very sort of mundane research. It's not. Application research are quite difficult. And that's one thing, in fact, we should do, focus and bring in innovation there. So these goes hand in hand, particularly in engineering research, that is both basic and applied. And again, there is, if you have heard of, some say I do fundamental research, Tata Institute of Fundamental Studies, and there are fundamental research. That's a relative term. Like in engineering, a fundamental research would be the person who is not using empirical model, model based on some basic rules, basic governing equation and things like that. But if you tell that to your physics friend, he'll think you are doing applied research, because your physics friend is doing molecular dynamics. Because everything consists of molecules and atoms. Whether it's a water you drink or air you breathe, they are all molecules. They are not continuous substance. So they will be saying, I'm doing the fundamental. And then if he talks to someone in the same department who does string theory, they'll say, no, you are not doing fundamental. I'm looking at small particles. I'm doing more fundamental. You are looking at molecules. So it's a relative term. But so don't worry about that. As long as your research is useful, the end result is useful, you should embark on that, basic or applied. This is something I think everyone should try to do at some point of time. Maybe it will be difficult to come initially when you're starting. but have a big picture. I mean, this almost goes with what my colleague Prof. Amarnath, you know, you have something, you know, you are targeting what you do. Similarly, have a big picture in mind. It's not that you want to get more data and new information and publish and get five more publications. Don't really have those as your goal, even though you can't escape that, because those are the short-term gain which will give you enough momentum to go on. But there should be always a long-term goal, a big picture. So, you know, let's say if you are talking about a civil engineering problem you want to solve, particularly in the city of Mumbai where you have very strong monsoons for 5-6 months. You want to develop, let's say, building materials, okay, that withstand the monsoon. There is no leak, water repellent, super hydrophobic, self-cleaning and things like that. You know, something ahead of you and which is quite difficult to achieve, because that keeps you sort of giving you that drives you to sort of put more effort, go extra miles and reach that. So that is one thing is, but it doesn't come easily in the beginning, but as you work on it, you'll find that you yourself will generate such kind of scene for you, that is, have a big picture. And you have to choose research problems, and it can come if you think hard, okay? But the better way to talk to people, observe things, okay, and interact with people, interact with industry people, and all these will, you know, will help you to finally identify some problems you work. You work with your students, and keeping that big picture in mind. Okay, so that is the kind of more or less most those who are successful in, you know, research. One is they focus, and second is they have a big picture ahead of them. So, and all these will come through interactions and through thinking and reading. Okay, so all these, you know, the blend of all these things. There is no easy solution to this. You have to interact with people. You have to interact with industry. You have to interact. You have to read. You have to think. All these one needs to do to have some problems to work on. Now, why do you do that? Of course, we have, you know, we have sort of talked about that a good deal. But there should be some visible output for any effort you put in, isn't it? There should be visible output. That output should be recognized by others. Okay. And R&D outputs, particularly, if it is, are measured in terms of there are two kinds of output, one can say. One is very well defined. This is called productivity indicator. Okay, those are numbers, like number of publications, number of patents, number of books written, and, you know, those kind of things. Those are simply productivity, that, you know, you have been active in research. Now, other is quality, which is difficult to define. Okay, so quality indicator, which is difficult to define. But that is most important than the productivity indicator in the long run. So you have to keep that in mind. And quality indicators, I need not read all this thing, but in the ultimate high quality R&D work in engineering, I believe should find its way into the classroom textbooks, maybe 10 years after the work is done, or it's being utilized in industry to develop a technology. That is the ultimate test, in my opinion. And otherwise, that is really doesn't happen in many cases, because it's not that the quality, but it's certainly the it's sort of guaranteed best quality work, you can say, if it goes into textbook, because you want students to learn it. So it's a piece of research so generic, so valuable that you want to put into the textbook. Or it's so useful full of commercial potential that industry takes it in. But normally it doesn't happen, maybe one or two in one's career. Then what you depend on is good quality publication or good quality patents. Okay, it need not be utilized in industry, but industry would like to probably buy the entire portfolio of patents you have done. You might have done 5-6 portfolio in a particular area, 5-6 patents in a particular area, and put together they are valuable. So industry would like to simply buy that out. They may implement, they may not implement, depends on their business thinking. We have no control on that, but they want to buy out. So those are, in my opinion, quality R&D output, and you have to keep that in mind. You have to be careful that you don't just go on producing papers, go on the, you know, just counting numbers and not looking at the quality, okay? Now with this, we are going to get into proposals and things like that. Before that, if you have any sort of comments to make or your experience to share with other participants, you can do that on your R&D experience. Let me tell you from the at the very beginning that R&D in engineering is expensive. And that's one of the reasons where you have R&D in good amount in places like IIT, IIC Bangalore, and not in all engineering colleges, because it's simply expensive. And you need good sum of financial resources to have R&D activities, because you need research facilities in terms of sophisticated equipment, high power computing, then good support for consumables, and you know it's expensive. Now obviously you can't, it's a chicken and egg story. Unless you have done some work and established yourself, you can't attract grant. Okay, and unless you get a grant to begin with, how do you establish yourself? Okay, there are large number of government organizations which give research grant starting from few lakhs of rupees to few crores of rupees. Okay, individual research grants are, you know, few lakhs or few tens of lakhs of rupees. All India Council for Technical Education, AICT, and then there is a list of government organizations. Now, how do you approach them? Very simple. With today's net world, it's not difficult at all. Now, all these government organizations have excellent website, very informative website. In fact, most of the forms you are going to fill up to apply, you can download from the site. And all the instructions and informations are there. So all you have to do is a visit to the site and download the form you would like to fill up and get your information. Okay? And most of these organizations have variety of schemes so that they can cater to a larger section of researchers. Okay, some researchers are starting out. So you may need some seed grant, some initiation grant, young engineers grant, you know, things like that. So you may, this is your beginning, maybe you can go to that. And that way you can break that chicken and egg thing, that you just pick up the scheme where they are trying to solve that problem, you know, giving you just an initiation grant. Or you are already an established researcher and you want to get into the next level by upgrading your research facilities and other things, then you need a huge grant. So there are some thrust area scheme and other scheme which gives grants to the tune of crores. Okay, so you can get into that. So you have to choose the right scheme and then make an application. So this is of course just the procedure, but there are a lot of details to it. But these are all available in the website. One can go to the website and get all those things. For industry, you may not have things in the website. It's not simple at all. And as you know, industry is thinking and government thinking are somewhat different. Government thinking is more to give grants so that promotion occurs, you know, promote science and technology, promote innovation, promote manpower, these are all promotion purposes. Where industry links to the business, okay, also promotion in a different way, but is more into the business. And but the industries which are doing very well, they don't look at you to solve the day-to-day needs because they have the resources in their organization, in-house resources to do that kind of thing. They want to sort of, you know, partner with you to borrow your brain to do things for them for future. Okay, so that is the kind of, you know, they think they have in mind when they look at academics, academic professor in industry. So make use of or utilize the intellectual capital available among the faculty in a particular institutions to build partnership and bring in their business interest and develop, let's say, capability, the company's capability for the future. Okay, so you have to keep in mind the industry is, you know, industry is not donating money or giving you grant, even though it will come in the grant form. It may be a research grant, but they are not giving you grant as government organization would give. They are looking for something. So those, for that, you have to interact, you have talked to the industry, you know, you can focus on 2-3 industry in your area. Okay, now, suppose, you know, precision manufacturing, the gentleman. So he has to look at few industries which are fabricating that kind of products. And then you have to network and find out what kind of things they are thinking. And then based on your own R&D reading and thinking, you know what is, how the technology is going to take shape in 10 years or 15 years down the road. And then you have to talk to them and say, you know, we want to build partnership and help you develop your capability of developing this tomorrow's technology. Okay, so then they will come and give you grants. Okay, and second attraction they have, which my friend mentioned, that they get subsidy, they get tax benefits. Okay, so that they will do that. But industry, getting a grant from industry is a little more difficult than getting a grant from government organization. But I would strongly encourage you to get grants from industry because you have to develop that skill as well, and it's more close towards sort of practical implementation than doing something very, very sort of basic and academic. So you may have two proposals from, let's say, government organization and one from industry. So knowing the source, whether it's government organization or from industry, now you have to prepare to write proposals, okay? Now, it needs good amount of homework, basically. And to focus that homework, or as you said, the design, the homework you want to put into write proposal, you have to think about the deliverables in that proposal in a way. Now, what do you want to achieve? Okay, now research is uncertain. You know, you don't know what would be the outcome. That's fine, but still you have to sort of, you know, think what are the possible outcomes, okay? Or what are more probable outcomes, and how is that enough to write a proposal? Is that enough to attract grant? Okay, so you have to, and the simple deliverables would be like, you know, thinking about publication, patents, or the research infrastructure you are going to build out of this grant, or the manpower you want to develop. You know, for example, if you say I'm going to, you know, to a government organization, if you say I'm going to have 3 project staff who are going to do their masters with me, that is a manpower development in a particular area. So that's a good output, you know. So you see what are possible, you know, you cannot, the deliverables are should be, you know, it's you can't really be very ambitious. But it's good to be ambitious. You can't even, at the same time, don't be very ambitious because it would be difficult to convince the sponsoring agencies. So these you keep in mind. Now, at the beginning, that these are my possible deliverables. So when I do my homework to write a proposal, these are the possible deliverables I have in my mind. And these, of course, you know, since you are going to drive the entire project, so whenever a sponsoring agency looks at the proposal, the sponsoring agency will look at you, your competence, your track record, and your those things. And naturally, the research proposal would be in the area where you have strong interest to carry out R&D, and you have some research strength in terms of your knowledge, expertise, and the facilities available, and your research team. So these are your research resources. And also, this is quite common, that you don't reinvent wheels. You don't do things that has been already done. And to ensure that you don't do that, you do a literature search. Isn't it? You do a literature. And these days, doing literature search is quite easy because of the e-databases. I don't think all colleges have it. Do your college have e-database? Yes, that's very good. IIT, of course, has it. Like, for example, Scopus, Web of Science. Yeah. So, if you focus on a particular topic, then you can go to these databases, and in a matter of hours, you can get the search done, and you know what has been done and what is available in literature. And then you see, your objectives in writing the proposal, your deliverables, how they fit in what is not there in the literature. Basically, what they say, existing gaps in knowledge, okay, and all these things. So this is basically the homework, and this takes a lot of time. And of course, getting the literature search done these days are very easy, is a matter of hours. But going through the, reading the key papers, making, listing the advancements, identifying the gaps, and constructively critiquing the paper so that you can take it to a next higher level, all these take time. But once you focus in writing a proposal, these can be done. Then you have to see what you need, and you need a number of instruments, you need a number of facilities, okay? And then this is very important. I think this is the last two one. We don't put so much emphasis, even places like IIT and IIC Bangalore, the safety in carrying out the work. Then the ethics of carrying out that work, and that is also coming into picture now, particularly in some biological research. And safety is very important. See, right now, it probably doesn't matter as much because our research activities are not at a very high level. It's not that intense. But if you have intense research activities and if you are not following the safety precautions, then accidents would occur. And once you have one or two accidents, I think IIT Bombay, we had a couple of accidents in the last 2-3 years, and now we are working on putting in the safety things in the lab. And this is very important. If you find the work, the experimental work you are going to do in your project are in general unsafe, if you don't have the safety wares, then please don't do it. I think that's definitely this thing. And many cases you'll find there are knowledge available in the form of books and manuals. So what are the safety precautions you take if you carry out a particular kind of experiments? And likewise, if you are into the biological work, then there is a bioethics committee. IIT Bombay has one, not many places have. they go through whether it's a sometimes it's just a formality because nobody gets into unethical work anyway. But that is also something you got to check before you decide on the particular project. Okay, so these are the things or what you say your homework. These are the homework one does before actually sitting in front of a computer and start writing. You have your literature search done. You have some idea about what are the possible deliverables, and you have some idea what are the facilities that are existing in your institute and the facilities you need so that that gets into the proposal. And then some idea about the safety and other things that you are going to need. So now you have whatever you need to write a good proposal. Okay. So, and also based on that, you have gone through the list of sponsoring agencies and you have made up your mind that, you know, I am going to give it to this agency. For example, if it is entirely, let's say, aerospace related, you want to go for a aerospace agency. Yeah, that's very sort of common things. So then you have to follow their format because each sponsoring agency has different format. However, there are some common things. Okay, so that we'll go through very quickly. And first thing is, of course, objective of the proposal or the problem definition. Okay. Now, this is one can write down, you know, I want to do this, I want to do this, I want to do that. But okay, now those are fine. Those are, you want to do that way. But then the question will be asked that why you want to do this. Okay. And sometimes if you write in a listing manner, it turns out that you confuse, the clarity is lost somewhere. So if you have a lecture, so what is the problem that you are going to solve? What is the problem you are going to solve and define it very clearly. So clear problem definition is very important in your proposal. And writing the objectives of the proposal, what you want to study in a clear manner is also very important. Okay? These are usually short sections, half a page each. But it should be clear, crisp, and focused because that sort of builds the impression of the sponsoring agency or the reviewer of your proposal about the project proposal. Okay. So that should be clearly written. And then, of course, literature search you have done. There is always a section on literature search because they want to make sure that you are not reinventing the wheel. You are doing something which is significant. So that is supported through your literature search. And then comes a very important sections. That is the method of approach. Essentially, how you are going to solve the problem. What are the, if you want to do a, take a computational approach, okay? Now, do you have the right algorithm? Do you have the right software code you need? Do you have the technique? Okay? Or if you want to carry out the experiments, okay, now what is the kind of experience you have in doing this kind of experiments? And do you have the instruments or you are proposing to acquire the instrument through this research grant? Okay? Now, this has to be also, this is very important because this sort of convinces the reviewer that you have a good chance of successfully complete the project. Okay, so now because you have some clarity how you are going to go. Again, it may not be all clear because you don't know what would come. It's a R&D proposal after all, but you have some initial plan, initial design how you want to approach in solving the problem. Okay, that. So here, basically, sometimes it's a good idea to give details of your experimental plan, and also what kind of data you want to collect, and how you are going to interpret the data to, okay, to develop the knowledge or generate the knowledge you want to generate, or how that will help you to solve the problem if you have focused your entire proposal in solving a problem. And this is where there is a bulk of the proposal. In fact, this usually runs into 4 or 5 pages. Okay, whereas the problem definition and objectives may be put together 1 page, this could be 5 or 6 pages. And this also brings in your competency in dealing, you know, somewhere reflects that in sort of handling that particular project. And then manpower is very important. Okay, now one other thing is, particularly these colleges where you want to nucleate these activities, you can think in terms of giving good fellowship amount. Okay, now you have to find a way, innovative way to do that. And of course, you don't give money from institute kitty or from your own pocket. It all should come from the project. So you have to budget your manpower in such a way that you have this kind of ability. You have built in this kind of sort of scheme or facility to give higher fellowship to the students, to give fellowship to the undergraduate students if they are working. So we have been talking about research grants. So these are the grants given by government agencies in the industry, and these are like donations to do research. Okay, so they are not really looking for deliverables. However, government organizations like MHRD, AICT, particularly those who are into manpower and education, they want to see you are really taking project staff, training them, and sending them to industry. So that manpower training is a very important deliverable, all these projects. So you have to keep that in mind. And then, of course, basic research. This, I think lately, it wasn't there 10-15 years back. Lately, almost any, even for the research grant, you have to sign an agreement. This is not contract research. This is not consultancy. But you are just taking a research grant. Even for that, you have to sign an agreement. Industry has agreements. Lot of government, like your Department of Science and Technology, Department of Biotechnology, Defense, DRDO, all of them have their own agreements. Agreement means basically the scope of work, activities to be performed, the financial terms, and then some on due diligence, then confidentiality, non-disclosure and stuff like that. And one important component is the ownership of IP. IP is intellectual property. You are familiar with that? Yeah, IP is a generic name where patent, copyright, trademark, design registration, all these come in. Okay, let's come to the other kind of research. This is also R&D, but it's a slightly different kind. It's known as contract research everywhere else, or in America particularly. In India, we call it industrial consultancy projects. Okay? See, consultancy is a big thing in IIT Bombay also, because we are located in Bombay, and Bombay is full of industries, variety of industries, chemical and I spent some time in the Dean R&D's office, and I can tell you, it's very intense. Like IIT Bombay does close to 1,000 consultancy project every year. So we have 400 faculties, almost 2 to 3 projects every faculty on an average. But most of the projects are done by about 15 to 20% of faculty members. You know, they are really known as expert consultant. One big name is of course Prof. Pathak, the co-organizer of this course, and close to about 15 crores total consultancy costing for the year. So it's a big thing in IIT Bombay, and it really builds an industry partnership, isn't it? And you'll find that if you are known as a good consultant, you can also get a grant from the same industry, or you can get a better consultancy project. So it's a good way of building partnership with industry. You start with consultancy project and go to the higher level. So I'm happy that some of you have already started doing consultancy projects. As you know, these are short-term projects because time is money for industry. They are very short-term. It could be few days to few weeks or maximum few months. It's never more than a year. At least I haven't seen any consultancy project which is more than a year. Usually 6 months, okay? And the deliverables are clearly identified and clearly defined. This particular software package, okay, or this energy analysis or whatever, it's clearly defined and you have to do that and deliver in time. That is consultancy project. And most consultancy projects, depending on the industry, almost all these days come with agreements. Okay, now first agreement to sign is the non-disclosure agreement, that you are not going to disclose whatever you have done in this consultancy project for a particular company to other companies, which is fair. Okay, so that is there. And then, but the real bone of contention here is the ownership of IP. Now, while working on it, we generate something which has commercial potential, okay, now, and you can patent it, right? It's a technology. It may be a small increment, but it's a technology and it has huge commercial potential. Now, industry has given a project worth of 1 lakh, but you have developed this thing which has a commercial potential of such a few hundreds of crores. Now, industry would obviously like to own it. He's saying this is because you have done this in, you know, while doing this consultancy project. So they always come out with that whatever IP generated during this consultancy work would be owned by the industry alone. But we don't agree to that. Our line of argument is that whatever innovations or inventions you make while working on this consultancy project, okay, it has arrows from the experience you have generated in doing R&D for 10-15 years, working in other projects, working with your students. It really hasn't generated because you are, you know, what you happen to work in this particular project, but the knowledge base, your thinking and the intellectual capital you have used have been generated over the years. So since you have created some wealth, you know, through this IP, you would like to share it, okay, institute or to share it. And that can be done by the joint ownership. So IIT Bombay insists that whenever our faculty member signs agreement with industry on a consultancy project, we say joint ownership. In fact, it was getting difficult. So what we have done very recently, we have worked out a tenor, I think it was 10 point, it could be same now, 10 point standard agreements, okay, about all these aspects, you know, non-disclosure, terms of payment, arbitration, IP ownership, all these points we have taken care, okay? And these, we call it standard agreements. So if industry would like to give us consultancy project, this is the agreement our consultant signs with the industry. So you automatically taken, okay? So whenever you send a letter of, we call it job letter to our client, industry, on the back of the letter, we have this standard agreement. So this is, so that way we solve the problem. We have 1,000 consultancy projects. If you want to negotiate 1,000 agreements, you won't have time. Okay, so the most industries agree, but there are industries who don't agree to the standard agreement. they said, no, we cannot give this project. This project is very important to us. We cannot agree to the standard agreement. We don't agree to the joint IP ownership. Then what we do, we take it as a special case. We have our faculty experts who would like to take up that project, the industry experts, okay, now that team, and we negotiate. Okay, now we say, okay, now we will give you the joint ownership, but you certainly have to, you know, share the, you know, the wealth which is going to be generated in future with us. Either you can do in terms of an upfront payment, which could be like maybe 2 times or 3 times of the project, depending on this thing. There is, you know, there is no clear guideline on this. Okay, now if the project is for 5 lakhs, okay, you get 15 lakhs upfront. If a patent comes, you own the patent. Okay, and then that money is shared by IIT Bombay and the faculty member in a particular way. Because IIT Bombay has an intellectual property policy. Like if a patent comes, okay, patent comes up, then we have a policy who is going to share the patent. The patent is going to be owned by the institute, IIT Bombay. However, the faculty member and students are the author of the patent, and when the patent generates some money, okay, it will be shared in a particular way. So that policy is already in place. Okay, so you can get into separate agreement, but you have to be careful and take help, you know, if you have a IP cell or IP cell, we have, I think each IIT has IP cell now, you can also consult them. And make sure you have understand everything before signing an agreement, okay, particularly for contract research or consultancy. Of course, most of you know it, there are many kinds of deliverables in a consultancy project. The easier one is the testings, you know. You happen to have an instrument, okay, which does certain kind of specialized testing, okay. It could be the, you know, insulation strength, it could be viscosity of a liquid, or, you know, corrosion, you know, testing, or whatever, or structural, you know, some structural strength testing, etc. So you have built up this facility through grants, and industries need this kind of testing, but they don't need it on a routine basis. So they want to acquire the in-house facility for this, but they may need maybe few times a year. And if you already have the facilities and good track record of doing sound work on this, they'll come to you. Okay, and then these they come to know through your presentation in seminar, conferences, through your network, you know, your students, etc. You don't have to specially advertise it. You don't have to really do a template and send to all industry. It just comes out. You don't have to worry about that. So these are quite easy, and this IIT does good amount of this. Okay, so this, but this is. Most cases you really don't need research expertise to do this kind of consulting. Actually, it's more facility based. Then there are other types which are both facility and expertise based. That means you are directly applying your knowledge and expertise to do the consultancy project. So they are your sort of reputation as an expert in a particular area will be the main driving force for the industry to come for that consultancy project. So you have to establish your credibility. You know, most of the problems we get, the consultancy projects we get at IIT Bombay are problem solving type. You know, the industry gets a symptom which is very critical to them. Let's say in chemical industry, all of a sudden they find that the yield of a reactor, chemical reactor, has gone down tremendously. That means their profit will go down, their business will go down. I mean, this is something which is very critical to them. So that is the one thing, is it has gone down. Now how to solve the problem? So it's a problem solving. So they have to come to the expert, reactor expert in the, that kind of reactor, okay? And then they say, we have this, this is the major symptom we have, it is very critical. we want to get it done in 3-4 days. And could you help us? Okay, we get lots of this kind of problem solving type, you know, where they come out with just one symptom and they want to solve the problem. Okay? Or, you know, in a manufacturing plant, you find you are producing too many defective goods. You know, the defective percentage, you know, in Six Sigma and all, it is very, very low. But if you start getting into percentage, obviously you are going to make loss. Now what do you do? They will have some idea. In fact, sometimes you can talk to them and get some ideas. But they don't have the confidence to solve it, and they may not have time also, because this needs good thinking. So they would come to a faculty expert who can solve this problem in 2 days, 3 days, or a week. So we get a lot of this kind of problems, and some of our faculty experts do it. You know, and or you have developed a package to do energy audit or optimization of certain kind of processes, you have that package. You know, this is your own sort of expertise. So they like to come and use that, and you do that as a consultancy project. So those kind of things are quite common in our consultancy scene. Then process and product development. And this is, again, expertise based. And this is slightly more involved than problem solving. And these are usually long term. You know, for example, one particular plant wants to go from, let's say, 50% of utilization currently to 90% of utilization. Because something is happening, there are bottlenecks. You have to de-bottleneck, re-engineer and things like that. And take it to 90%. So you have to carry out modeling, simulations, all kinds of diagnostic kind of things, and you can do that. Or they want to, they have done a customer survey. They want a product which is slightly different than the product they are using. Then you have to, design that new product. So we get a lot of consultancy. On this in a different way. We have one called IDC, Industrial Design Center. It's kind of unique. Of course, Professor Vinay Kripal knows it. They get a lot of consultancy to design the shape and other things about the product, both from functional viewpoint as well as from aesthetic viewpoint, because both has value. You can have same functional, and if one product is more aesthetically more appealing, you can put 10 rupees extra there and people would pay. So that is there. Our IDC gets a lot of, even designing a sack to store cement, and things like, if you have seen that jet type petrol pump, in the petrol station, that is our design, IDC's design, and that looks neat and it's functionally also, more efficacious. So those kind of things project we do. And then the last one is expert opinion. This, in my opinion, this is the highest level of consultancy one can do. Of course, you have to earn the reputation or recognition as an expert. One example I can give in IIT Bombay, Prof. Pathak is an expert on software. Okay. Now, if a bank wants to acquire a particular solution, software solution, out of a, from a list of many, they would come to a person like Prof. Pathak. This is expert opinion. Or to make a particular chemical product, there are 3-4 technologies. Exxon may have one. Mobile may have one, or, different chemical companies have different technologies and they are all competing. How do you make a decision? You go to an expert who not only can see through the technology, their sort of advantage and disadvantage, also able to see the future and see which technology provides you scope to improve and get into the next generation of technology that is, in future. So this kind of ability or skill, one has to earn, one has to develop. you know. So then you get, we get, you know, some of our faculty members are recognized experts in industries, and sometimes they are kept as retainer. You know, you are retained as a residential kind of professor consultant or a residential consultant, where you go one day a week, okay, for a year, and they would consult you on various issues. So a lot of these experts are retained by 2-3 companies as expert retainers. Okay, keeping time, you know, you all know that this is very important, that you have to deliver in time. If you want to have a thriving consultancy going, you cannot but do this. I think you all probably know, those who have done, you have to do a bit of costing for your consultancy project. Okay. Now, what are the important cost components here? Of course, consultancy fee. So the consultancy fee is your charge. You know, you put a you know, charge for the time you put in, or charge for the expertise you give, your intellectual input you give to solve the problem or to do the consultancy project. You put a charge for that. That is consultancy fee. Then manpower cost is, if you want to recruit some project staff or if you want to outsource, then you put that cost. Then operational cost in, these of course are done in IIT Bombay kind of costing format we have. We have four major: consultancy fee, manpower cost, operational cost, and then overhead and all. And so if you have consultancy fee and manpower cost taken up, all other costs are operational cost. It's like your travel, consumables, your service, all these you can put it as operational cost. Okay? And then the institute puts a sort of tax on it. It's overhead, because you are going to use the water and electricity and, you know, other kind of infrastructure, the library, the computer to search and all things. So that has a cost component, and it varies from institute to institute, but it's usually good amount. I think we have done all this thing. Then there is service tax, and that has increased the consultancy this thing charge to industry. Industry of course doesn't like it, but government will collect service tax, okay, and that's about 12.7% now, that so 12.2 or something like that. So that you have to add, because you don't pay service tax from your pocket, you have to, and that's a good amount. So an industry would like to pay, because you know they are taking a service, you are the service provider. So that tax is there. We try to argue that, you know, this is educational institution, lot of money is going towards developing facilities for education, etc., but they won't agree, saying you are providing a service, so you have to pay the service tax, and that's probably fair in a way. So, and industry pays it, we don't pay, so that's goes. And this is very important. Don't have one idea or one proposal. I think it has been shown that that's not a good thing to have. If all of a sudden, if you find you don't find money for that idea or that proposal is not funded, then you know it's not very encouraging at all. So write at least three proposals or have three ideas going. Okay. And of course, you don't submit all three proposals to one sponsoring agency. You maybe write one for the one industry, two for two different government agencies, three different proposals. Okay. And then if you are lucky, you get all three funded, fine. You have to work hard. And if all three are successful, you are an expert. You will get a lot of consultancy. And there is a multiplicity effect, and you'll enjoy your R&D journey. Thank you very much.